Your Bibles, would you like you to lift your Bibles with me, please? And say this with me, this is my Bible, the Word of God. I am what my Bible says I am. I will be what my Bible says I will be. I have what my Bible says I have, and I can do what my Bible said I can do. The Word of God is powerful, and nothing is impossible with him. As I believe, I will receive. And everyone said, amen. Praise God. Let's now open our Bible, please, to the book of Exodus. Just put it somewhere in chapter 3. This material this morning, as I was meditating on it, is something that really was working and speaking to me, because it's a very day-to-day thing. And I simply entitled this, the word is excuses. What's the word? We're working on a subject on the youth service, and we're talking about, you know, encouraging the kids to be dreamers, that they should not allow anything to stop them in dreaming big dreams. We talk about why not dreaming big dreams. We talk about how do you know that the dream you have is of God. And we've learned that, you know, it is of God when it is beyond your ability. The dream you have is beyond your own comprehension. And it takes God to make it happen. And then part of the thing that you're working on the youth was the idea of people looking for excuse why they cannot do what God prepared for them to do. And that kind of worked on my mind, and that helps me to meditate on and on. So I end up really asking God, Lord, I think there's a thought here that you would like us to understand. So we're going to look at it this morning. We're going to look at four individuals we hope to address by looking at the life of Moses, the widow, and the little boy. But we hope that we can talk to people who have lost credibility on themselves, or lost trust on themselves, who have lost faith in themselves because of failures. They have others. Secondly, we are going to look at people who have compared themselves with others, and they find themselves unable to be competing to those kind of people that they think are better than them. Third, individuals or a group of people like to address are people whom God has called in the ministry but failed to kind of launch or really fly. And because of that experience, they started to just give up on that desire. And probably the last one are people who tried it, failed, and then because of that failure, decided not to pursue whatever they thought they cannot do anymore. You know, Filipinos are so gifted. We're so creative. God has given us so much ability to do a lot of things. But in spite of the many gifts we have, we seem to lose the idea of really finishing it to the end. And probably that's one thing that God is really going to work on us, that we are not just going to be good starters, but we will finish what we think we should be doing. A lot of people are good starters, but you know, our culture says that we're very poor finishers. We don't really push through the end. That's why Jesus said in the word that I am the author and I am the finisher. And that should help us recognize that God will play a big role if we're going to fulfill who we are as God has planned for us to be. Let's begin. Let's look at the book of Exodus chapter 3, verse 10 to 11. Who am I? Come on, let me go back to verse 10. Come on now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I? Why am I going to Pharaoh, that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? Let us pray. Father, we come before you this morning and ask that you teach us your word. We don't want to be complacent. We don't want to take the back seat. We don't want to take things for granted. We want to hear you and do your will. God, if it takes a rebuke, do it. If it takes to challenge us to make things happen, do it, Lord. Because there's only one thing we would like to do, to honor you in our lives. And tonight, allow me, Holy Spirit, to be your word, or to be your vessel, where your word shall be declared in your authority and power, and you would speak to us. For you are our God. Teach us. We ask this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, let's talk about Moses. Who was Moses? Moses was a very particular individual that God used mightily in their time. He was the deliverer of Israel. He was one of those men that God chose to deliver his people out of slavery and supposedly to bring them into the promised land. But something happened in between that he just stopped at seeing the promised land, but not able to enter it because of what he did when God asked him to do something. But when Moses was born, there was an edict at the time that all children that of age of Moses has to be killed. But by divine providence, the mother of Moses was able to protect Moses by allowing Moses to be adopted to the sister of Pharaoh, and Moses grew up as the daughter of as the son of the sister of Pharaoh, and he learned all of the wisdom, the knowledge available that Egypt can provide. And one day the Lord called him and started to reveal who he was, a Hebrew. He depended one slave, and the soldier was fighting, and he killed the soldier instead of the slave. And then the story went on, and it brought realization that there was something different in him. So that kind of a traumatic experience that he experienced, because that was the only time in his humanity that he faced so much pressure and problem, because he was a son of the sister of Pharaoh, and he had so many privileges. So he hasn't really experienced much of quote-unquote problems, but that was the first encounter that he had to face when people begin to know what he has done, killing and burying the soldier under the mud, and now everyone was talking about it. So he ran away. As a result of that encounter, when Moses ran away, for another 40 years, he just drifted. He lost his focus. He has not done what he should be doing. For the next 40 years, he was a nobody, tending a flock, trying to exist, just living for the sake of living. He wasn't fulfilling the call of God. He wasn't doing what he was supposed to do as God called him to do. He just drifted as the time and days and months and years passes by. So the day came that God would like to deliver his people out of the bondage. And God spoke to Moses on a burning bush and said, Moses, I have seen the misery of my people in Exodus chapter 3. I have heard them crying out. I have seen the slave drivers and how they were abused. Now I am sending you to Pharaoh to deliver my people out of slavery. And I want you, Moses, to bring them to the promised land, a land flowing with milk and honey. You, Moses, will deliver my people. You are the one that I have chosen to bring my people out of slavery. You, Moses, will be Israel's deliverer. I am sending you. That was the call of God. Here comes Moses, hearing all of this, looking at the burning bush. And then the first word that came out of Moses was in verse 10 of Exodus 3 and said, who am I that I should go? Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? The first thing that hit Moses was the fact that he was nobody. He has no sense of value on himself. Yes, he had a knowledge on Egypt. He has a doctorate degree on all of the engineering available in Egypt. He had all of the favor, the connection if he wanted to. But because of what happened one time, that was in a prison for him to drift away. Traumatized enough for one encounter, the devil used that one instance that he was so discouraged and not knowing what to do. He was so afraid that for the next 40 years, he lost his focus. He lost where he needed to be, what he needed to do. He just lost everything that God had to confront him. And when God confronted him, Moses said, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and I should deliver your people Israel out of Egypt? Who am I? I'm nobody. He didn't even remember where he came from, how he was trained and developed, you know, brought to a leadership position. What he knew was that he was a shepherd trying to exist and live day by day. And for 40 years, that was his life. And now he said to God, Lord, for the first 40 years I was in Egypt, but my second 40 years I was just trying to exist. Now you're asking me to deliver your people? God, who am I? There's no way that I am the person you are asking to deliver your people. He felt useless. He felt he was just, you know, an excess. He's not needed. How many times have we felt that way? How many times have we felt that the devil said, you're nobody, you're nothing. What are you doing there? Just, you know, just float around. Don't try to do anything anymore. You're a failure and you will always be a failure. And a lot of times we stuck this thing in our mind and thinking, yeah, I am really a failure. I'm nobody. I'm useless. I have no sense of value to myself anymore. I just need to eat, work enough to get a food for my table and just live and exist. But God was very strong. God said, Moses, you will be my deliverer. You are going to bring my people out of slavery. You are the one that I want you to bring them out of Egypt. So Moses has to think of that. Even if the thought came into himself that says, I cannot contribute anything. I cannot do anything for anyone. I cannot even hardly, you know, help my own family much more deliver a group and a bunch of people. Second excuse Moses did is found in Exodus chapter 4. So God was able to convince Moses that he's the one who was trying to make an excuse to get, Lord, you know, who am I? Verse 1 said in chapter 4 of Exodus, but suppose, Moses was answering God, but suppose they will not believe me or listen to my voice. Suppose they say, the Lord has not appeared to you. Moses already decided in his mind that people would listen to him. How true is this to us? How many times did we tell ourselves, even if I tell them, they won't listen to me. Even if I call them, they will not answer me. Even if I do something for them, they will not respond to me. You haven't even seen what you can do, but you already made up your mind and tell yourself, I cannot do anything anyway anymore. Why would I do that? Why would I have to pursue that agenda? And you know, the scripture is very clear because Moses was really saying that to the Lord. Yeah, suppose I go. But suppose they would not believe me and would not really believe that you spoke to me and I heard you. Moses was just emphasizing, making, you know, the little thing, the big thing in his life. And that is seeing himself as unable to do anything for God. Third excuse Moses did is in verse 10. Of Exodus chapter 4. He said, then Moses said to the Lord, oh my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither before nor since you have spoken to your servant, but I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. Jeremiah said the same thing when God started to lay him out for becoming a man of God. Jeremiah said, I cannot speak. I am but a youth, in Jeremiah 1 verse 6. Same thing was said in Zechariah 4 verse 6. You know, I can't do it. There's no way I can be what you would like me to be. There's no way I can be a successful person. This is going to be my life. And God was speaking to Moses saying, no, excuse me. That is not how I called you and I created you. Moses said, I am not eloquent. So for the sake of Moses, God said to Moses, okay, Moses, if you think you cannot speak, I'm going to send Aaron with you. And Aaron will speak in your behalf. But notice, when we see the story in the book of Exodus, when Moses and Aaron was in the presence of Pharaoh, who was talking? Was it Aaron or Moses? It was Moses. In himself, he said he cannot. He cannot speak. He cannot articulate. He cannot say anything that may give attention. But by the end of the day, when he was in the presence of Pharaoh, it was not Aaron. It was Moses who spoke to Pharaoh and spoke about the will of God for the nation of Israel. Many, many times, this is happening to the believer's life. How many times did God told us to do something? Share the gospel to somebody. You know, just pray for that person. And what do we say? God, I'm not eloquent. I can't do it. I have no ability or I have no gift of gab. I cannot speak the way others are able to speak. I just can't do it, Lord. Moses had the same excuse. When God calls us to do something, always remind yourself of this. If He asks you to do something, it is because He believes you are able to do it. Now, God is God. He knows what He's doing. He's not dumb. He's not a fool. He's not guessing who can do the job or not do the job. He knows every human being alive down to their DNA. So when God comes to you and tell you do this and do that, it's because He believes the ability is in you. Yeah, give God a hand of praise. It is the truth. Why would God ask you to do something you can't do? Why would God put you in a position where you will only shame yourself if God knew that you will not be able to do the job? He does not call the equipped, but rather He equipped those whom He has called. He does not look for those who are better. He equips those who need to be better for as long as they're willing to be used of the Lord. God never put a person in a position where they could not do the job. God expects something to somebody because He knew that person can easily do the job in Jesus' name. Now, if you still doubt yourself, remind yourself, that's no more God. It's now the devil. The enemy of God telling you you're nothing. You are worth nobody and no one will listen to you. That's the voice of the enemy of God. That is not the voice of God. If you know that it's the voice of the devil, do not listen to it. But listen to the voice of God that speaks to you and is calling you to do what you need to do. And everyone said, say to the person beside you, He calls and equip them. Don't look at your ability because if your ability is concerned, He's the giver of abilities in the first place. If God chose you to be the one doing the job and you happen not to see a gift or ability or talent in you regarding that particular thing, no worry. God can speak the word and that will come into being. If you will study the Old Testament, you will find out that the people who God used in building the temple of the Lord were gifted, given the gift, the skill, the talent, and ability by the Holy Spirit. It's very clear. The Holy Spirit came over them, gave them the gifts, the talent, and the ability to do the job in fulfilling the call of God. Moses said, God, I'm not eloquent. I can't do this. God said, okay, if that's what you think, I'm going to send Aaron with you to encourage you for that you don't have any excuse. How many times have we used this as an excuse for ourselves? One, we said, you know, who am I? Second, we say, who will listen to me? And third, we would say, I'm not a good speaker. Listen carefully. God believes in us. That's why He called us. He gives you a dream. He gives you something you need to pursue because He believes you can make a difference if you insist on what God laid in your heart. The Bible tells us that He inspires us to fear Him. God equips His people to do the job, but He gives us the desire first. That's why the book of Philippians says, it is He who gives us the desire to will and to act according to His purpose, according to what He desired in our lives. Stop making excuses. And everyone said, give God a hand of praise. That's for your life. The fourth reason or excuse that Moses gave to God was this. Verse 13 of Exodus 4. But he said, oh God, oh my Lord, please send by the hand of whoever else you may send. God, you know, I know you believe in me. Cool. Send somebody else. I mean, where's the brain? I mean, God said, yes, I'm calling you to do the job. And here you are saying, yes, Lord, send them. When God spoke to Isaiah, Isaiah voluntarily said, Lord, here I am. Send me. But others who heard Isaiah said, yeah, God, here I am too. Send him. When are we going to stop making, well, I can do it. I can do it. I can do it. Well, they said that goodies and good things and good packages come in cans, not in cans. When you say, I cannot, I cannot, I cannot, you are true. You are prophetic by your word. True, you cannot. But if you say, I think I can, I will try, I will, and my will try to do it, you will see the difference of what you can become. Mag-una magunin atong katalawgot. We always allow the fear to go ahead of us. The courage is lost simply because you were not knowledgeable on some issues. Well, that's why before a mother, the first, you know, before a woman delivers a baby for the first time, her firstborn, she has 9 months to learn how to become a good mother. It takes 9 months to take care of a child. Enough time for a woman to know how to take care of a child, how to be a good mother, a good parent to a child. God doesn't give the child to a woman and say, okay, you will now be a mother. Bang! Tomorrow you'll deliver a child. No, it's only an alien who does that. But regularly, God gives you enough time to learn things how it can be. Moses was saying, Lord, wrong choice. I can't do it, God. Send somebody else. Well, say to yourself this word. I am the right person for the job. God believes in me. And I can do it. Amen. You know, sometimes we're so humble, we don't want to accept who we are. They already know that you are cum laude, and how do we respond? Oh, congratulations, you're cum laude. We try to say, No. If you're cum laude, just thank God with it. Praise God, hallelujah, I'm cum laude. Don't act like, hey. It's typical Filipino way of saying, I know. when you are appreciating, they say, oh, you look good today. Praise Jesus. Don't say, oy, dali, oy. Daina, sige, batikag now. Sometimes we go to an extreme that's no longer right. If God calls you to do it, it's because He believes you can do it in Jesus' name. Say to the person beside you, I believe God can. Through your life. Amen? Fifth excuse of Moses. Moses wasn't done. You think Moses was very sharp? Oh, he was very sharp in looking for an excuse. Number five, excuse of Moses. Verse 22 of chapter 5. Exodus 5:22. Now this was real, Moses said. So Moses returned to the Lord and said, Lord, why have you brought trouble on this people? Why is it you have sent me? For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has done evil to your people. Neither have you delivered your people at all. Now, if you look back to the story, when Moses keep on talking, among you watch the movie, The Ten Commandments. Some of you, what did you watch? Eight Commandments? Remember the story when Pharaoh was going to when Moses was going to Pharaoh, and there was this challenge, because when Moses would tell and show a miracle, Pharaoh would harden his heart. And what did Pharaoh do? He doubled the quota of the brick that the slaves need to finish, and they lessen the food and they take out the rest that they normally would take. So it was harder for the people now because of Moses coming to Pharaoh. So Moses went to God and cried out and said, God, you know, when I didn't go to Pharaoh, they were doing just this. But now I came to Pharaoh and spoke with him. He doubled the quota of bricks that they were doing. They took out the rest, and then the food was lessened. You know, it's not helping. And then if you will notice, by the end of that statement, Moses said, God, you didn't deliver your people. You didn't do anything at all. I was doing my portion, but where's your portion, Lord? Now, how do we translate that on our time? How many times you were so excited because you know this is what God would like you to do? You know by your heart that this is what God would like you to do. But along the line, you messed up. You made some wrong decisions, and it flip-flop. You stumbled and fall. And as a result, it was worse than you have started. But you know, at the beginning, you were called. So you then begin to think, I don't think I'm called to this. I don't think this is my task. Now you begin to consider yourself unable. Now you look at yourself, I'm not capable. Because instead of growing my business, I only closed it down and went bankrupt. I started with a little, but I end up with creditors behind my back. When you follow the will of God, please be reminded, the devil is still alive. You're not going to walk on a bed of roses simply because God calls you. In fact, the devil will do everything possible to stop you in doing the will of God for your life. He will give his best shot to stop you. He will do everything that is closest to your heart so that you would not pursue the agenda of God in you. In fact, there will be times you would separate from where you were called. You were separate from your parents, separate from your friends, separate from your church, separate from your colleague, because you felt that, you know, it's going worse than good. Well, always be reminded that the devil is alive, and the Bible says he's roaring and roaming like a lion, seeking whom he may devour. Especially those who are doing the will of God, he's going to do everything possible to stop you in whatever you're doing for him. So don't be shocked when things are not easy. But remember, it's not your strength, it's God's strength. If you go back to Moses and Pharaoh, it was not Moses' power that was being revealed when the sea turned into blood, when there were frogs flying around, when there were diseases, and at the end of the story, the firstborn even of Pharaoh dies. It wasn't Moses after all, it was God. in Moses. So please be reminded and remind yourself, it's not me, it's going to be God who's going to help me. I could not reach my quota. I could not even close a deal. Hey, it's not you, it's God. And God will do what He said He's going to do. He has not failed, He will not fail, and especially in you, will never fail. Well, good for you, pastor, because you're a pastor. Excuse me. The most attacked individuals are those that serve the Lord. Why? Because the Bible tells us, if you strike the shepherd, the sheep will scatter. The easiest to destroy, if you want to destroy Christianity, attack the shepherd. You know, cause the pastor to commit adultery, cause the pastor, you know, to commit a sin, and the whole church will be destroyed. And what will the devil do? Do everything to make that pastor commit the sin. When he's alone doing counseling, the devil will come. Oh, this is a beautiful woman, just needed time. And then here comes adulterous relationship already. Oh, the worship leader and the pastor having a relationship. The secretary and the pastor having relationship. The janitor and the pastor having relationship. Whoever the devil can use. Why? Because he does not want them to do the will of God. So don't think that it will be easy on the pastors. It's double fold attack on them. If that is the case for the pastors, good for the people of God who's doing the will of God, it's going to be lighter. But it doesn't mean it will be easier. It will be different. But the same thing is true. When you follow the will of God, the devil will be there to do everything to stop you in doing the will of God. He will do everything. Just stop doing what you're doing for God. And when you're tricked by the devil, now you will begin to hate. You will hate the people who love you. You will hate the church. You will hate the friends that cared for you. And now you go somewhere else that will destroy your life. And you will generalize things and say, well, it's just the same. If I go to this church, it's okay. It's still God. Well, excuse me, they can serve anywhere in the desert, but not with the God of Moses, because God said, and even Jacob, he said, the God of Jacob, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, they always go to the place where God would lead them. They would always worship God at the altar the Lord told them to go. They could not just do it anywhere. The success God gives to us is based on geography. And geography is based on the call of God. Where God sets you up, where God placed you, that is where you bloom. That's why God said, planted in the house of the Lord is where you will grow, nourish, flourish, like the cedars of Lebanon. You got to put that together. Just because you feel discouraged and you feel like you have been isolated and rejected, you would make decisions based on emotions, please. I think it was Mike Grunger who said, women change their mind 8 times every second. Multiply that by a minute times 60. Multiply it by an hour. So you don't change your decision based on emotion. You make decision based on the will of God and what is right. Not because you feel bad. Because we will always feel bad. You know, you will be feeling good today. By noontime, you will feel bad because you don't like the food. Or the food upsets you. And then later on you will feel good again. Please don't let emotion decide what you're going to do. When God says that this is what you're going to do, stick with it in Jesus' name. The fifth excuse was very clear. Moses said to God in Exodus 5:22, God, why have you sent me? It's only making things worse. If that is the case and that's what you feel, welcome to life. Because if you don't want this, the best thing to do so that you would not be quote-unquote bothered, you don't want to be pressured, you don't want to be facing challenges, the best thing you do is die. Because when you die, no more problem. Wanay maningil, wanay sigig paluap, oy, basa ba kag Bible, simba ba ka? Oh, kumusta imong pag-awit? Oh, imong connect group? Oh, ingon ka, mag-commit ka na sa Ginoo, anong Nag-commit niya po kasi mo siya. No one will die. Good morning. Say to the person beside you, he's talking to you. It's always easy to say that than to talk to yourself, right? That's what we call excuses. The sixth excuse Moses said to God is found in Exodus 6:12. Moses spoke before the Lord saying, "The children of Israel have not heeded me. How then shall Pharaoh heed me? For I am of uncircumcised lips." Moses said, "God, the people, they're not listening to me. If they don't listen to me and I'm supposed to deliver them, how can Pharaoh listen to me? God, plan B. Look for somebody else." God simply said, in effect, to Moses, "Moses, there is no plan B. It's you. No one else." Say to the person beside you, "No plan B. You are it." I think he doesn't believe you. Say it again. You're the one. And no one else. He doesn't believe you. Say it to the other side. You're the one. And no one else. May pa yung mga Bisaya, musulti, puslan man. Puslan man. You have been chosen. And thank God for it. No turning back. Hello. Moses, there's no plan B. "Lord, they don't listen to me. Pharaoh wouldn't listen to me." Okay, so what's your plan, Moses? "No, change. Change plan." God said, "No, no other plan. It's you." "Me? No." "Yes, it's you." "Ah." "You can cry all you want. You still need to do the job." Hallelujah. Yaw-yaw, hilak, buhaha diha. Paguman anak, ikaw lang yapon. Trabuhan na lang. Just like a mother talking to a child, they would say, "Nak, wash the dishes." "Nak, wash the dishes." "Wash the dishes." "You're not going to eat until you wash the dishes." By the end of the day, he has to wash the dish. And all good people of God say. So what did God do in those six excuses of Moses? God asked one question. He said this to Moses in Exodus chapter 4 verse 1. Look at what God said. Then Moses answered and said, "But suppose they will not believe me or listen to my voice. Suppose they say the Lord has not appeared to you." So the Lord said to him, "What is that in your hand?" What is that? What? Moses was holding a stick in his hand. What's in my hand? Stick. Yeah. What is it in your hand? Stick. It's just a stick. Can you not see it? And you know what? Many, many times that's what we do with God. God said, "What do you have in you? What ability do you have in you? What talent have I given you? What gifting have I given you? What have I given you? Is it just a simple talent to sing? Just a simple talent to dance? A simple talent to, you know, make a poem? A simple talent to write an essay? A simple talent to write 3 books in 3 weeks? With 300 pages each? Back to back with a font of 8. And single space. I have nothing to offer God. Just this. What is it in your hand? Just this. And you know what? That was the very tool God used for Moses' life. the thing that you have in your life is what God is going to use in bringing the miracle in your life. Whatever God already gave you, whatever you already have in your hand, is what God will use in bringing the miracle in your life. God did not say, Moses, look for a stick. God said, what do you have in your hand? Big difference. When God said, what you have in your hand, it's already in you. When God said, look for a stick, that means it's not yet there. But God spoke to Moses and said, Moses, what is in your hand? He said, a stick. You have it, right? Yeah, it's a stick. That's the one. What do you have in your hand? A gift to cook. There you are. What do you have in your hand? I'm a good accountant. There you are. Well, I'm an engineer. There you are. Well, I have contacts with this and contacts with that. There you are. What do you have in your hand? In accounting principle, this is probably what we call inventory. What do you have in your hand? What has God given you right now that's in you and can be taken away from you? What do you have in you? And that is what God is asking you. And do not even take it lightly. Well, it's nothing, God. It's just... Well, that's the whole point. Why we're missing it out? Because we look at what we have as nothing. What you have is what you need to bring where you need to go and to bring what God's plan is for your life. When God asks these questions, why? Yeah, give God a hand of praise. Because He already gave the gift. He already has it in your life. You don't have to look for it. You just need to discover it. Because it's there already. God gave it to you. And everyone said? Now say to the person beside you, you are gifted. You are a special child. Not abnormal, but above normal. Amen. You don't have to drink Promil just to be, receiving a gift of God. What you have in your hand, all of us have something already God gave for us to do the will of God. Naa na na ni mo igsuon, ayaw na pangita o wala. Unsay anaa mauy gamiton. And everyone said, that stick was able to turn the 10 miracles in the presence of Pharaoh the way it was. That stick was able to divide the Red Sea. That stick was able to win the battle as Moses was lifting up his hand with that stick. They were winning battles. When that stick goes down, they were losing. That stick was bringing the miracle for the nation of Israel, and that stick was the one that brought them water in the desert where they're almost to die. That simple stick that God gave to Moses, that God gave in the hand of Moses, was the stick that is already provided for by God before he even talked with God. Before God even commissioned Moses, he already provided what Moses needed to do the job. Well, you said, well, good for you, Pastor, because Moses was a man. But I'm a woman. I'm not Moses. Besides, I'm a widow. I don't have a husband anymore. I'm a single mother. No one will help me. Well, if that's the case, let's look at the widow. 2 Kings 4, 1 to 7. Excuses, excuses, excuses. When are you going to stop making excuses? One person said it this way. Everything is good, but after the word but in a statement, it's of the devil. Say anything you want, but when you use the word but, any word after that is of the devil. Oh, you're beautiful, but. You're handsome, but. They said, after but is already the devil. So no more but. Amen. Murang dagang abat. 2 Kings 4, 1 to 7. A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know how that your servant feared the Lord, and the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves. So Elijah said to her, what shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house? She said, your maidservant has nothing in the house, but a jar of oil. Then he said, go, borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons. Then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones. She went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons who brought the vessels to her. She poured it out. Now it came to pass when the vessels were full that she said to her son, bring me another vessel. And he said to her, there is not another vessel. So the oil ceased. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil, pay your debt, and you and your son shall live on the rest. Let's learn from this widow. The widow said, my husband is a God-fearing man. He serves the Lord. He's a prophet. But we have a lot of creditors. He was not a good financial engineer. He was good, you know, he was a good consumer. And now I have many creditors behind me, and they will take my son to be their slaves. Elisha, the prophet of God, please help me. What do I do? Elisha answered the widow, okay, what can I do for you? What do you have in your house? If you are a person with a lot of creditors, I think you should listen to this. The prophet is telling you this now. If you have a lot of utang, what do you have in the house? I know your answer will be the same with the woman. I have nothing. Three refrigerators, four televisions, two dining sets, four LEDs, five LCDs. Lord, I have nothing. You know, if you're indebted, go and check your house and sell it. My favorite TV? Sell? No way, Jose. Then let your son be a slave. Now, God said to the widow, what do you have in your house? If you are really indebted for a long time and you want it stopped, look and get an inventory and sell what you have in your house. If you don't own the house, don't sell it. Hello. I'm selling the house that I'm renting, Pastor. Yeah, you go to jail. But this is the point. It's easy to tell God, Lord, I have nothing. How many times did somebody come to you and said, do you have money? Can I borrow? What do you say? I have nothing. I have nothing. Only 1 million on my pocket cash. I have nothing. Can you help me? No, I cannot help you. I have nothing. We belittle so much what God already provided. So God would tell you this. If you are fighting with indebtedness, look at what you have in the house. As God said, sell it. But before he commanded the widow to sell it, God did a miracle. And what was that? He used what was in the house to multiply what he does not have. So think, if you have a, call it, when you do mango shake, blender. You have a blender in the house. It's now summer. Wonderfully raining on summer. What can you do during summer? You have a blender. You blend the sun. No. You can sell halo halo. You can sell anything that you can blend. You have a rep. There's nothing in it. Sell ice water. Make an ice plant out of your rep. Of course, you can do something in the house. But you know what was interesting was this. When the widow was told by the prophet, and the man of God told her, go get all of the empty vessels as much as you can. Don't just get a few. Get all that you could get. And then shut the door behind you, and then pour the little jar with oil to all of those barrels. Now, the widow knew that he has a little jar of oil. He knew where that oil can go. But she listened to the voice of God. When she closed the door, she started pouring the jar with little oil. And boom, it didn't empty itself. It kept on pouring. It kept on pouring until all of the vessels that her sons were able to gather was all filled up. And then she said, "Son, give me some more empty vessels." And the son said, "No more empty vessel. Bisa galitong baldi sa atong pikas balay, gidala na ako, nay. And there's really none more, none that I could get." And when there was none, the oil stopped pouring. That tells you that the miracle only stopped when you stop acting on what God told you that you're supposed to do. If you started acting in faith and you stop doing it, the miracle will stop as well. But if you insist on doing what God would told you to do, then you will see the hand of God will keep on moving and moving and moving and moving until all of the empty vessels will be filled. One commentary said that after the woman was able to fill up all of the empty vessels, she was like a woman who was able to buy a property, a small property, but underneath was a big reserve of oil. He was very rich after that. The Bible tells us that enough oil that was poured into the vessels was able to pay for all of her debts and was able for them to sustain life and bring future to her sons. She struck an oil, so to speak, an oil reserve on his roof, but not underneath, but just a miracle of God being done. What you can find is very simple. A simple act of faith is enough to bring the miracle in, but you must act in faith. And everyone said, a little faith is enough. When you follow God by what he said, God will show you what he can do when you step in faith. He was willing to pour it out even when he knew that, when she knew that it was just so little. And she saw what God has done. And lastly, don't worry, before we take lunch, we'll get one more example. Let's look at the example in the New Testament where, you know, there were 5,000 men who were hungry during that night when Jesus had a crusade and they needed to eat. Mark 6 verse 35. When the day was now spent, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place. Already the hour is late. Send them away that they may go into the surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat." But Jesus answered and said to them, "You give them something to eat." They said to him, "Shall we go buy 200 denarii worth of bread? Give them something to eat." He said to them, "How many loaves do you have? Go and see." When they found out, they said, "We found out we have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Then he commanded them to make them all sit down in groups in the grass, green grass. So they sat down in ranks, hundreds in fifties. And then when he had given thanks, the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples to set before them. And the 2 fish he divided among themselves. So they all ate and were filled, and they took up 12 baskets full of fragments of the fish, and now those who had eaten the loaves were about 5,000 men. One commentary said it's approximately around 15,000 individuals, counting the wives, the women, and their children. Wow, another miracle. They said, "You have to feed them. Let them go home and let them buy their own bread and food for the evening." He said, "No, feed them." And one of them said, "What? We need 1 whole year's salary, 200 denarii, just to feed 5,000 men, not counting the women and their children. How can we do that? Walay julis diri, walay panadero diri. How can we go ahead and get this bread?" You said, "What's the problem? Check out, what do you have? How many do we have here?" So they went, check it out, and they found a boy hiding his 5 loaves of bread. And why do we know that the boy was hiding it? Because they have to look for it. If the boy was volunteering his food, they would have not looked and searched anywhere. The boy heard that that was the instruction, but he tried to keep it, one commentary said. But whatever they were looking for it, or the boy hiding it, it really doesn't matter, because the fact was that they were able to bring those 5 loaves and 2 fish. And they distributed it to them. As they keep on dividing it, the bread never was lessening in its size. The miracle fed them. And the Bible said 12 basketfuls of fragments, leftovers, were kept. That you can imagine. 15,000 men were eating with 5 loaves and 2 fish. One atheist said, that was not a miracle on itself. You are not knowledgeable on the word. The Bible did not say how big the bread was or the size of the fish. The atheist said, the bread was huge. There were 5 huge bread that they found out. And then they got a whale for the fish. The problem was, it was the boy's lunch. How can the boy carry 5 huge of bread? 5. Naglakaw-lakaw, sunod-sunod kang isus. Saan na dong? Pamay, paniyapon. Yan, nagbira siya o balyena, iha o iho. Para usan na dong? Merinda. Yan, ingon tong ATS. The ATS said, it was not a miracle because there were 5 huge bread and whale of fish. What they did was just get a pinch of, you know, each one of them getting a pinch from the whale. The real miracle there was that how can the boy eat all of that by himself? Because the Bible said it was the boy's lunch. Can you imagine how people try to discredit what the miracle is when it comes to God doing the thing? God said the same question. What do you have? You should answer that question. Start from that inventory. Now begin to ask yourself, God, what do you want me to do with my stick? What do you want me to do with the jar of oil? What do you want me to do with the 5 loaves and 2 fish? What do you want me to do? Someone has put it this way. Shamgar had an ox goad. David had a tirador. Samson had a jawbone. Rahab had a string. Mary had an ointment. Moses had a rod or a stick. Dorcas had a needle. The boy had 5 loaves and 2 fish. The widow had a little jar of oil. And that was the beginning of a miracle for their lives. Let's quit making excuses. Let us be responsible. If you're failing, it's because you make that decision. If you run away from your responsibility, it only proves your immaturity. If you don't face your problem, even if the problem is your face, you are not taking responsibility in yourself. They say it as a joke, but really the truth of the matter is, we don't run away whatever we face. We face them in Jesus' name. But I don't think I can do this. You'll be amazed what you can do when you just face your problem. God will give you the strength, not just to face it, but to overcome it and win it. As Paul said, I can do everything through Christ who gives me the strength. Well, I have done everything already, Pastor. Well, what does the Bible said? In your weakness, their God's strength will be yours. My grace is sufficient for you. You don't have to look around. God already provided in you what you need in order to bring what God would like you to do in your life. Running away from people does not solve any problem. It will only worsen the situation because you carry it in your soul. For example, because I'm a pastor, my usual encounter are church. There is no church member who goes away from his church and moves to another church because the church had a wonderful revival meeting. Oh, I left the church, Praise Cathedral, because I was having fun there. Nobody goes out like that. They always go out of the church because they have issues in their heart. well, I don't want there because of this, because of that. Well, do you think by going out of the church solves your problem? No. You carry it in you. As one book said, the church was perfect, but you came. No one is perfect in this house. We are all growing and knowing each other. That's what commitment is. That's why there is a family. A family, in spite of the failures, in spite of the wreck and the mess, you stay committed. Why? Because this is how life is. This is how you grow together. Amen? Now, if you look at me, you will fall immediately tomorrow. Look up to God. He's perfect. If you look at me, you will only find so many wrong things. But I'm allowing myself to be used of God because He wants me to do this thing. But don't use any other excuses in your life so that God can no longer use you. Allow the Lord to grow us up. These are part of growing up. Amen? We grow together. We grow committed. We grow with whatever God is going to do. But we grow together because that is where maturity comes. And all mature people of God say, Father, we ask you this morning that your grace be upon us. We're not perfect. We have so many excuses we abuse so many times. And a lot of times, God, those excuses becomes a sin before you. Because we have neglected our call. We have rejected your goal you have set for us. And now we have understood that what we need to do is hang on, hold on, and learn from all of this so we become better. Holy Spirit, we ask you this morning. We're not perfect people. We make mistakes. In our perfection, help us. Make us stronger, Lord God. We want to serve you with all our hearts. You know, for the years have passed, you have seen. And for the times that we have not been committed, you have seen it as well. But God, this morning, help us to do what is right. Say this prayer to me, Lord Jesus, forgive me for running away. I come to you today, humbling myself, asking you, Lord, to strengthen me in my heart, in my mind, and in my decision making. I ask you, Lord, to make me the kind of person that you want me to be, for you are my God. Help me, Lord. I can't do it by my own. But the Holy Spirit, who will never leave me nor forsake me, I will trust. Beginning this day, I will face whatever I need to face. And you will give me the strength to move forward so you will be praised. You are my Lord. You are my Savior. To you I trust. In Jesus' name. Let's give God a wonderful hand of prayer. Father, we give you all the glory and honor and honor.
Glory! Thank you, Jesus. We give you all of the praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
No more excuses. Amen?